Hi, Aaron. Welcome to the National Queen's Choice Online News. And Aaron, I know that you're one of those well-known artists here in Southeast Asia, including Singapore.
Yep.
We came to believe that you just sold 9 paintings just before the opening.
Yes, it's been a very busy day.
Amazing. Now tell us, what is your secret of your success as a artist? You know, could you give us some three key points on how you have succeeded?
Three key points.
Yes.
I would think that you need to focus and basically specialize in what you like. First is obviously your passion. You must love what you're doing. After passion is hard work. You need to, personally for me, I've been living, breathing, eating, drinking art or watercolors for the past 12 months. It's been a very big sacrifice on my part. I basically just threw everything aside for 12 months and just do it. Without that kind of commitment, you still need to go through the journey, but it will maybe take you maybe by 40 to 50 to maybe reach the kind of just technical competency. We don't talk about the profound philosophy or meaning to great art behind, but just the technical proficiency, if you don't put in the pure number of hours, you won't be able to reach it. So hard work and passion, I guess.
Now, you spoke about hard work and passion, you know, and a lot of people say passion is the most important ingredient in making your business a success.
Okay.
But did you have a business manager that helps you to sell your work, or did you go about selling the work yourself?
No, I have never attempted to sell the works myself, even though I can, but I chose not to do it. I believe my friend used to, I used to work in a law firm, that was many years ago, and we sort of have I used to have an inside joke with my lawyer, he's my boss. He said people will try to do brain surgery, on themselves if they can do it, okay? Basically, it means if you want to do anything yourself, you usually can. You can fix the car yourself, you can cook dinner yourself, but it will always be better to let whoever is good at doing that particular thing do it for you. If you're good at painting, you paint. Art gallery sell, they sell. Don't try to go into their area. We should respect them for the work they do, lah. So I would, on my side, if I'm just speaking at the moment, if possible in the future, I would still try not to sell any of my paintings if I can. Painter should paint. That's personally my belief, lah. I don't do things which is not your specialty.
And so now, when you spoke about the passion and even the the business side of it, is it important for the artist to realize that they have to consider the business side of it more than just passion?
I think they should consider it, but not too much. Okay, they should consider it in the sense that they should realize that they shouldn't try to do it themselves. They should let the gallery owners do it. That's my own perspective, lah. The other thing is, they shouldn't be too affected by the business part, because there are many artists which, in a bid to survive in the industry, because you need to sell paintings, and to sell paintings, people like to buy Boat Keys, Clark Key, Chinatown, and they paint what people like to buy, or they paint what I call sweet paintings, lah. Nice, colorful, sweet. You put in the house, nobody will say it's not nice. Okay, everybody, oh, beautiful painting. So, but once you paint that way, sometimes I speak Chinese, lah. The painting is dead. Not to sound too negative, but the painting is dead. It's a dead painting, lah. 画到死了, 我们每次讲. I'm not sure whether you have read out of my paintings, but I like Chinese paintings a lot. Basically because the good ones are the right ones, the Chinese paintings, they are alive. They have the brush strokes. They have a hanyi, what we call hanyi. They have meaning to it, okay? So when you paint it too sweetly, when you look at the painting, it's just okay, nice painting. Ah, okay. Basically, when people look at my painting, I don't want them to say, oh, this is a very nice painting, or it is very well done. When they look at the painting, they will say, wow, the painting feels very breezy. It feels very windy. It feels very dark. It should feel something, not, wow, this is a very well done painting, which a lot of people actually say when they look at certain kinds of paintings. So I guess, if not to get too affected by the business side, we should just paint what we like and paint with our hearts, I guess. That's what I'm trying to say. I know this carver, he's a Chinese seal carver, but he's behind the scenes. He has done a lot of the seals for my paintings, and he writes sort of small poems or meanings to the seals. I draw my inspirations from his seals. So, but because he's, to me, he's a true artist because he's not affected by sales. He does his own business, but purely for the love of art and Chinese culture. So when you look at the seal, you can feel it. You can feel it. It's just, you can feel the seal. And purely from feeling the seal, I can paint a picture out of a seal. So that's how great it is. When I read the seal, I read the words inscribed in it. Some of my paintings are based on these seals. Got one is called Wei Hua Mang, which means Wei Hua Mang got double meaning. A lot of the things got double meaning. Which means when he was young, he used to chase girls. Now when he's old, he just carves seals. Then for that, I drew a picture of a sunflower field, something like that. There's a field where it's about heavy rain. Then I drew a stormy rain scene. So I guess when you really love art, you will paint things which transcends realism, which means you don't just sit down, you see Chinatown and you paint. Then that would be just like a documentation, which I believe art should be beyond that, beyond documentation.
Amazing. Now, when did you first got your inspiration that you are destined to be an artist?
I've always wanted to be an artist when I was young, meaning from primary school, actually before that. I love drawing since young. I just like to doodle and I can doodle well. I think the ability to doodle well or draw well is quite innate, meaning if you can do it, you can do it. I just realized this as I got older. Some people just cannot draw a circle, or they see Mickey Mouse, when they draw the Mickey Mouse, it doesn't look like it, even though it's just three circles. I know this for a fact because my music is horrible. I feel my high in pinging. I cannot do the four in tail, and I can't do do re mi. It's very obvious. So whereas I'm good in art, so I know that I have the inner ability, okay? Because I know I'm that bad in music, but then because of that, I know I'm that good in art because I see once, I can do it, just once. For other things, I see 10 times, it maybe comes back to me 10% or something, okay? So from then I know that I can do it. And I think I'm very fortunate or lucky. To be a full-time artist, you need a lot of, you can call it serendipity or just good fortune. There were many great artists before me, Gog Sing Hui, Chen Wenxi, and quite a few. Some, but a lot of them, they couldn't go into it full-time, so their potential was never fully realized. Because at that time, they couldn't make a living doing it full-time, because there was just no buying market. So they had to be a secondary school teacher, a secondary art teacher, or they teach at NAFA, all this. But I always felt that it was such a waste that they were so talented, but they couldn't paint every day, 8 hours a day, for them to realize their full potential. So they started maybe painting every day, 8 hours a day, when they were 50s, 60s, and they achieved their recognition in their 60s, 70s. Gog Sing Hui was the... I'm very distressed by Gog Sing Hui because he passed away early. And he never got the fame or recognition that he solely deserved. These people really work so hard every day until 8, 9 p.m. go back and paint on weeknights and Saturdays, Sundays. But they never got to live their life as a full-time artist. Then I see in modern Singapore, we have art galleries. As it globalized, we actually have a market for it. And we can make a decent living out of it. We are given a chance. Most important is we are given a chance. And since we are given a chance, we shouldn't waste it because those who were before us never had the chance. So if we, even though the chance will entail great sacrifice on other areas, if we have a chance, we should just take it.
For your upcoming showcase here in Singapore this weekend, which is happening in a few days' time, which is watercolors.
Yep.
Now tell us, where did you get your inspiration from in creating such great works in your watercolors?
I have a friend from China, and she told me something which I didn't realize until I started painting greatly, is that there's a lot of great artists in China, but not so much in Singapore, without offending anybody, because China, they have very great cultural upbringing. Not that we are uncultured, okay? I'm not so good in the English and Chinese thing. They need to study Buddhism, Confucius, Tao, and I think they got Mengzi and quite a few, which I love reading coincidentally, but which a lot of Singaporeans, they don't read. I read Zen, I read Zen is close to Buddhism and Chan, and Taoism, Tao, there's Zhuangzi, Laozi, Mengzi, all this I read. When I was younger, I read Islam, Buddhism, Eightfold Path, a lot of things. And I think if you don't read that widely, or if you don't have a certain level of culture, not to sound too high up, too morally upright, but it really shapes the thing when you draw. You see, when you read about maybe Zen or Tao, it gives you a more philosophical way of painting. Like when I paint, I just start, and then I'll let the painting guide me through. So which means in the end, maybe when I'm painting, the house doesn't necessarily look like the house when it's done. When you don't go against the way, the paintings will be correct. The path will open up for you.
So the way you manifest your art will differ and mature as time goes by.
Sorry?
In other words, what you're saying is the way you exercise your craft will mature as you grow up.
As you have more life experiences, as you read more. Of course, you must have a certain technical competency to translate what you feel internally onto the paper. But once you reach a certain amount of technical competency, to go beyond that will be a lot to your life experiences, which I happen to have a varied amount of, and because I read widely as well, which I think some people might not have the chance or might not have the interest to. Like some of my friends, they don't like reading. Nothing wrong with that, but they just don't like reading as much.
So do you think that today, here in Southeast Asia, including Singapore, people are given the opportunity to exercise their passion on a full-time basis, such as art?
Southeast Asia or Singapore?
Oh, Singapore at least.
That's a complex question which might take days to debate. Okay, it goes along. Okay, this might sound a bit divergent. It's like asking whether the government is providing a good environment for people to have kids. Okay, people who say yes will always say yes. People who say no will always say no, and both are right. Okay, I know that sounds a bit complex. It is. Government has done a lot. At the same time, there is still a lot that leaves to be desired. Okay, they've done a lot. Like, for example, NAC provides fundings. They do a lot. They do the biennial, even though they cancel it. They have museums. They have a lot of. They give a lot of opportunities. They have Gilman Barracks. They have art galleries like this, Singapore Watercolor Society, Singapore Art Society. They have societies, they have people doing it, they help the societies, they do a lot of things, but artists will never be satisfied, or people will in general never be satisfied, because they want more. Like, you give me 10,000 for childcare, I'll say it's not enough. Because even though they do a lot, it really is not enough. 10,000 child bonus is gone in 12 months. Okay? So they do a lot, and for that we are very grateful. But you see, in Singapore, it has, or at this point of time for our generation, everybody wants a condo and a car. And you cannot maintain the current lifestyle without, of course, this is my own personal, maybe it's 5 to 10,000 monthly house monthly income. Okay? Of course, you can say the Malays, they are happy with 5 children and 2,000 a month, they live happily. Okay, so that's what I mean when people who are say it's enough will always say enough, people who say it's not enough will always say it's not enough. Okay, so that's why it's a complex question. But if it, because Chinese unfortunately has the what we call Confucius system, where we are governed by the self, then the family, then the government. So because of this, we always want to have a certain status in life, okay? And because of that, not many Singaporeans or Chinese, or in general, even the non-Chinese, they want a certain status in life. And to do that, to have that certain status in life is, as an artist, starting out is quite tough, mainly because you cannot start painting and command $5,000-$6,000 a month immediately. There's a gestation period of at least maybe 5 to 10 years. And then of course there's the biggest thing obviously is the opportunity cost. If you don't make it, you go back to the commercial side, your peers are earning $5,000-$6,000 as an accountant, you are earning $2,000-$2,800 as an admin executive. So the trade-off is great and the risk is great. So not a lot of people will take the risk. Not many sane people will take the risk, unless that guy is very passionate like me. the odds are against you in the sense of society pressures, I guess.
Moving forward, you know, what advice would you give for aspiring artists?
I give very unconventional advice. I think my way is a bit... Someone asked me this question. They asked, if one day my daughter grows up, and she wants to go NAFA, Nanyang Academy of Fine Arts, or some arts academy, will I approve, will I encourage her? Because people, in general, I'm not saying for all friends, don't like people to really want them to go business school first. I think I'll give her the advice which I personally took. I told my friend this. For someone who, if you graduate with a business degree or a lawyer, okay, if you graduate as a lawyer, you can choose to be a lawyer, you can work in the bank, you can start your own business, or you can be an artist. If you graduate from NAFA, you can be an artist. Full stop. So, the path you take, I would usually recommend to take the path which gives you more options in life. Okay, once you have a successful business, you have $1 million, you can retire comfortably. Okay, obviously, you need to do that while you're young, maybe 32, 35. Then you come and be an artist. So you have a big chunk of savings. Then you don't have to worry about the sales of your art. You can paint what you like. And then with money, you can maybe attack the business side a bit because you have money. There are a few US artists where they basically bought their way to international fame. Okay, so I believe for aspiring artists, even if you graduate from NAFA, all this, you must try to find a source of income so that it allows you to pursue your passion without compromise. But obviously, if you take the route of being a lawyer, business, all these things, you lose about 10 years of your youth and your chance to paint and learn from great masters who are teaching in NAFA. So everything has opportunity because it really depends on which way you want to go. See whether you want to burn the ship and force yourself into dead end, which is not a bad choice sometimes because you will be forced to succeed, or you take the safer way, which is, I guess, what I did, a slightly longer way. But to me, because I read philosophy and Zen, I prefer the middle way where I don't get too stressed out.
What's your most memorable experience in your painting, career? Was there one painting that actually inspired you the most, and you actually sold it off with a lot of heart pain?
Memorable painting is actually a pair. It's called, it's titled Hope and Calm, H-O-P-E, Calm is C-A-L-M. In general, art galleries, they like to Chinatown, Moki, okay? But I painted this pair of very, very dark paintings. It's a very dark, stormy sky, okay? King Hawk is very gracious enough to take it without any comments, and it's so off, okay? Obviously, it was a dark and stormy sky because I was going through, without elaborating, a certain dark period of movement in my life, but at the bottom, there was a bridge. Okay, so the bridge is supposed to, I would just like to say that no matter how dark or how bad the situation is, there is always a path out, a bridge leading you out. For the other one called Calm, it was very dark and stormy sky, but underneath the lake is calm and peaceful. Okay, so when there's turbulence all over the place, relax, calm down, look, and you realize that there's peace and quiet somewhere. Okay, so don't panic. Okay, so those things were very meaningful to me. But usually you will expect these kind of things to be quite a hard sell because it's dark and stormy. But I think less than 1 month they got sold off. And yeah, I think the guy who bought it put it in the office, which is actually the correct place because politics has come and then you need to find peace and a way out. So then I realized it's correct to persist my way and not paint Boat Quay. I mean, I do paint Boat Quay at Chinatown, but people do accept things that you paint with passion. I think they see it. So because of that, I was very encouraged. I started pushing the boundaries. I painted more things which I really wanted to paint or express. So that was, to me, a turning point, where I really can paint flowers, paint birds, paint whatever I want to paint.
Now, you spoke about your turning point. What would be let me put it this way. If you had to start life again, would you pursue as an artist if you are given a chance?
Yes, definitely. I mean, I would still a bit philosophical, but I'll just take back whatever road I've taken up to this point. Even from young or secondary school, before making a particular decision, I would ask myself, given the same set of circumstances and given the current amount of information I have, is this the best decision I can take or have to take? If it is, then I will just take it, even though the opportunity cost or consequence might not be so good, because I believe even on hindsight, it might seem like a bad decision. As long as at that point of time, given that amount of information I have, it is the best road I have to take, then it's the road I have to take. So if I'm not sure if I'm answering the question, but if going forward, I had to live the life again, basically I would still come back to the same point.
What's next for you after this showcase?
Okay, apparently the sales has been really, really, really good. I'll be pushing the issue even more. I want to exaggerate the paintings even more. There was some painting I always wanted to do, but I haven't done it yet. Basically, I want to have a white piece of canvas and have a seal, because actually the cover who did the seal for me have this seal that says Kong. So actually, I want a white canvas with just Kong and one name there. I'm not sure whether people can accept it, but by right, that would be very... I'll put that in my house, nobody buys it, I'll put that in my house, okay? So, yeah, moving forward, I want to move in that direction, where less is more, but I just want to emphasize that there's a certain journey we need to take, not where the new contemporary artists come out and they actually, without the certain foundation, they jump to the abstract or they jump to the nothing is everything kind of thing. But I think if I can, with my certain amount of success or background, I can push it slightly to a more zen-like place for my paintings, or furthermore.
Amazing. And so right now, Aaron, so you decided to pursue further into more contemporary boundaries after this. And so before we go, we want to thank you for joining us here at the National Creative Choice and sharing your passion. And hopefully, if there was one thing that you have looked back right now, what will be your philosophy of art today? What is your philosophy?
I want people to be happy when they look at my paintings. Because sometimes contemporary art, they tend to shock or provocate. Maybe they talk about social or political injustice or so. But I think in Singapore, when after a hard day's work from 9 to 9, you come back home, you don't really want to see a painting which is full of anger or anxiety. I want something to come back to, so I have some nice zen-like pictures or happy pictures, colorful pictures. Just take maybe one small step backwards to art where people decorate the wall and makes you happy.
Once again, Aaron, thank you for joining us here at the National Good Stories, the Stienberg Review. I'm Robin Stienberg. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you.